Hello everyone, welcome to Jagruti Yatra's Meet the Yatripreneur Google Hangout series. My name is Anant Krishna. I will be the moderator for this series. I'm asking the questions to our Yatripreneur today and moderating the discussion on your questions. Please use the Q&A tab on your top left-hand side. And then when the time comes, I'll call you out and you can ask the question yourself. Today we are in Delhi. We're with Shantanu Gupta. He's in the field of education, skill training and policy. He's founded the UR Foundation. Shantanu, welcome to Meet the Yatripreneur.
Hi, Anand. Thank you for having me.
Welcome. Can you give us a brief intro of UR Foundation?
Anand, 2010, I was in the Yatra. After that, I was a facilitator there, so many thoughts came, talked to so many people. And I was working in the social development sector anyways. And I found a huge ignorance in the youth at large on policy issues. So I thought, let's focus on something which is working on UWA. Working on UWA means the youth, and have a huge voluntary engagement. That's why UWA happened. Which is if you expand, it's called Young United Voluntary Action. And then we founded three, four key thematic areas in it. One is to teach children voluntarily, and we call it Yuva Pathshala. Then the policy angle, which we call it Yuva Sansad. And then we do a lot of internship research projects with college youths. We call it Yuva Coach. And then we do a lot of hygiene-related, health-related projects in slums. Let's say now, hopefully soon, we may start a Clean Noida campaign, which we call Swasth Bharat. So these are the four thematic areas Yuva works on.
Right. Now, you had a corporate background. You were busy in corporate life. When did that shift happen to a social setting? When did you start getting interested in the social, you know, causes and policy and all that?
I worked around 8.5 to almost 9 years in corporate, spanning from Wipro to Mercedes-Benz to Amdocs. Last, I was in Zurich working for Credit Suisse Bank. I was a business consultant and process consultant from Wipro, working for in Switzerland for a year. And I think it might not be one single incident. In all these companies, I was very active in the CSR, and I think somewhere the calling was coming I think that's not the field. In fact, that time in Zurich, I was preparing for my GMAT. I was scoring 750, 760 in my practice tests. I was visiting a lot of B schools, and my plan was to go to any of the big B schools and take the MBA route. But I think it happened in one of the meetings in Credit Suisse. They were launching a new instrument, financial instrument in the London market. And there were six of us. It was a little confidential kind of meeting, and they were like debating on the instrument. And when they asked my opinion, they literally caught me napping. And then I realized that my heart doesn't lie here. When like six people are almost fighting and I'm almost napping in a very serious discussion, right? On a multi-crore. And then I realized that, okay. I think just 7 days before or 8 days before my GMAT, I dropped GMAT. And I thought, let's study political science and social development. I looked through all the courses. Luckily, quickly got into LSC and IDS Sussex and decided to go to Institute of Development Studies, University of Sussex. So
did an MA in governance there, right?
I did an MA in governance.
And then you started with Nandi. So walk us through that. You know, what made you come back here and join Nandi?
So in fact, my purpose for studying outside was one. First of all, there are not very many good 1 year masters. And after 8 years of experience of working, basically, it's difficult to spend 2 years on studies, right? So UK 2 years master, 1 year masters, and IDS, LSC, SOAS, these are three decent ones, and there's a good amount of Indian gathering there. In fact, to my college, Indian government sent 5 to 6 IS officers every year. And very fortunately for me, a lot of international speakers used to come at IDS Sussex, and Manoj Kumar, who's the CEO of Nandi, he happened to be one of the guest speakers in IDS once. And then I think we roped in over discussion after a session. And during my winter break in December, I met him, and he almost offered me a job. I think I should call him brave on his side. that he gave me. July after finishing July or September after finishing my project, I joined as heading the Andhra Pradesh education portal. It was a multi-crore, big, huge project. So that's why I'm going to brave on him. Trust me from full corporate background, just 1 year in master's. So yeah, that's how I landed in.
So what exactly were you doing? And you were slowly, you started with primary education, right?
Right. So in Nandi, it was a very interesting project. So I started with the Hyderabad project. So Hyderabad has some 800 to 850 government schools. We were running remedial classes in all these schools after school hours. So I had a staff of around 1,000 people. It was funded by multilaterals. It was a huge, some 6-7 CR project. I had a full-time team of 70 people reporting into me. I have 1,000 teachers with me, paid teachers with me, and huge monitoring evaluation was happening. So it's a very interesting research base. We did a randomized control trial on it. Research base that can remedial education improve the learning outcomes of children? Because I think the assumption was that every wealthy kid takes some kind of help after school hours, be it teachers or tuition. And such a help is not available to poor kids because their parents, in many cases, are not literate enough, or they don't have time and they don't have money to go to tuition class. This very important component is missing from disadvantaged children. And now that Nandi and various other people have shown researches that remedial is a very important component in anybody's learning process.
Right. And so you move on from there. You come to Maharashtra with Nandi, and you slowly evolve into policy and government and donor investing and all that. Talk to us about that transition.
So I think as I grew in Nandi and as handling operation of the whole project in Hyderabad, some top leadership has left Nandi in Mumbai office, and Mumbai was coming with a big school excellence project along with McKinsey and multi partner. So Nandi wanted a seasoned Nandi person there. So my CEO requested me to move to Maharashtra on short notice, and I agreed. And it was a beautiful experience. And very interestingly, working in social field, a very small little role. So my wife is from Andhra. I was married almost for like 5 years when I joined Nandi, and hardly learned any Telugu. And during that 1.5 year in Nandi when I was working, I learned that now I speak decent Telugu. Because all of my staff was from districts.
Right.
They're not from
right.
Hyderabad. And they hardly speak any Hindi or any English.
Right.
And I have to work. And similarly, when I moved to Maharashtra, I didn't know any Marathi.
Right.
I don't know much either now. Because there my work was more working with the partners, working with McKinsey, and make sure that Nandi as a partner in the whole project fares good. Right. So that's why I moved to Maharashtra, to handle this McKinsey-led project of school excellence with government schools. And we were given the Urdu schools.
Yeah. I see. So Urdu schools in Maharashtra, you're trying to get them
in Mumbai. It was only a Mumbai-based project to start.
Only in Mumbai. And you were doing work with the government trying to improve the quality of these schools?
What we were doing, it's a government-led program which Nandi was running, and we have to take teachers, make them teacher trainers, and through them bring the change. So we have to bring the change through the government agents. But that's why there's a huge liaising involved, because you have to get government orders to take these teachers out, take them out of the training. You have to change the curriculum in the schools. You have to get books printed through the government machinery. So UNICEF was one of the founders, was a lot of hand-holding at every meeting with the Mumbai education head from the municipal. And Mumbai is one of the only few places in India where the whole schooling is run by the municipal, not the Maharashtra government.
And
politically, from last many years, Mumbai Municipal Corporation is held by BJP and Shiv Sena, whereas the Maharashtra government is Congress. So that conflict also hampers you and runs such projects.
Right.
So that was a very interesting experience to work in this complex political and government scenario.
We'll come to the political role a bit later, but from there, from Mumbai, from urban schools, you go to UNICEF. Talk to us about the UNICEF experience.
So in 2 years I worked in Mumbai and Hyderabad, and I was overseeing a lot of rural projects of Nandi also, or at least visiting them if some other leader was visiting there for learning, if there's some other leaders in Nandi were running it. So I went to many places in Chhattisgarh, tribal area of Chhattisgarh, Madhya Pradesh, Andhra Pradesh, and Maharashtra, and that gave me a sense that almost 65 to 70% children or people live and study out of rural schools, right? but my visits were 2 days, 3 days. I wanted to have a bigger role, a bigger understanding of the rural landscape. Unfortunately, there was no role available with Nandi because some senior person was handling it already. So that's why I moved to UNICEF. There was a very interesting role available in a district called Lalitpur. It's one of the poorest districts in India. It's in the Bundelkhand region next to Jhansi. So they were I was handling an integrated child project where they were integrating all the schemes to the beneficiary. Because currently, every department runs their own schemes, and one department doesn't talk to another. So a health department has a separate listing of the same children. The education department has a separate listing of the same children, and maybe the child labor department has a separate, same children, and they have the different people doing the same census. So this project was gearing toward, can we have our schemes beneficiary centric rather than department or ministry centric, right? That was a beautiful effort. So I was leading that effort, and there were some 15 partner NGOs which I have to manage there. And interestingly, my office was co-located with the district collector's office. And I was friends with all the office boys, the PNs, the work staff of the district magistrate. I was privy to all the meetings. I saw all the throwing of files on the faces and how the note sheet moves, how the note sheet doesn't move, how the minutes are circulated, the Hindi typing, everything is separate in Hindi, the new officer doesn't know English at times. So I understand the complex governance at the grassroots level, because what is the DM and SP dynamics, what's the DM video, what is the revenue department and the social development department. And beautifully, I was in 2012 in Lalitpur, and the UP election also happened at the same time. And if you know, in the election time, all such projects get a cease, because so that it should not look the government is helping the electorate, right? So almost 2-3 months, there was no work. So I was traveling even more widely in the villages and see how the election process is being happening and how they're co-opting. I tried to co-opt me also, because I have my staff in all the villages, right? There's a very beautiful understanding of how the governance work and how the politics and governance works, especially during the election time.
Right. Now, that explains your move to Center for Civil Society next as a policy advocate, right?
Right.
And then you start UA. So is that the basis for UA, or did you start UA parallelly before?
After UNICEF, the UNICEF project, UNICEF normally works in the project mode. My project got over and I have to look out for another opportunity. And now I had a decent understanding in last 4 years almost with Nandi and UNICEF of the urban education scenario, urban governance, and the rural and tribal governance. And also because of the election, the political scenario also. So now I wanted to move with this understanding to a policy advocacy and luckily landed into CCS. The Center for Civil Society is a free market think tank, and their motto is social change through public policy. So they don't believe in that. They don't believe in a Nandi model that you spend your own money, donors' money. They say you spend the money in the policy. So their philosophy is that if you spend donors' money, maybe you can show a pilot or you can affect 1 lakh children or 2 lakh children. But India has at least school-going 20 crore children. But if you do a change in policy, that can rapidly change the life of a lot of people. So that's why the motto is social change through public policy rather than direct implementation, right? So this understanding, my understanding of the schooling structure in rural and tribal, I joined CCS, and there my work was advocacy. Advocacy was primarily with 3-4 actors, actors being politicos with either parties, politicos in the education steering committee, politicos in MHRD, bureaucracy in MHRD, state politicians in education department or education minister, and the state bureaucracy. Right. And a lot of pressure groups like UNICEF, World Bank, and other big NGOs. And then third stakeholder, the media. Right. So this around 2 years that I spent in CCS gave me a very good bandwidth for understanding of, and in between a lot of elections came and gone, that how they play with policy and politics and what appeals to a politician. In fact, I can't name, but one of the politicians once told me that politician will only react to something which will pay them electorally.
Right.
And education, for some reason, doesn't pay them electorally.
Yeah.
And because education is deferred gratification. So if a fifth class child studies good or bad, that doesn't show up in the face, right? Versus a good road, versus a free rise, versus a free TV, versus electricity, right? That shows quickly, right? But a child's education only shows when he's in 10th class or when he gets a job. That's a, right. kind of a very huge and long gratification.
Right.
And which is a self killer for education. That's why people don't demand it, and that's why our politicians don't cater to it. And many people told me this, that education advocacy needs a very different level of understanding of education.
Right. Right, go ahead. Sorry, go ahead.
Yeah, and your other question on Yuva. So while I was in CCS itself, because I was taking this session with policy, so CCS done this beautiful 3-day iPolicy session, where they conducted with journalists, with NGO leaders, with a lot of youth, a lot of college-going students.
Right.
And through a 3-day session, they take them through how the policy is being framed in India and what are the different viewpoints you can critically analyze a policy. And I used to take a couple of sessions, especially in education. And there I again realized that connecting with youth can provide a very powerful voice to the youth and can inform them and can, and this youth from Stephens, from Hindu College, from IIMs, from IITs, from various places take good position in the future, right? Be in government and private, right? So if they are informed rightly, right? So I saw it as a beautiful, beautiful medium. And an organization can only provide you a limited platform because organization has global policy. And that time, while working in CCS, I formed Yuva. And in my informal capacity, on weekends, on holidays, I started taking session on education and various policy and politics issues with you. That's how Yuva started.
So Yuva is basically a non-profit. Have you established it as an NGO, or what exactly is the legal structure?
So in India you can establish a not NGO is a very generic term, so there is no registration in India for NGO. Tata and Reliance are NGO, they're non-government, right? So it's a misnomer. In fact, NPO is a better term, non-profit organization. So in India you can set up a non-profit by three ways. One can be a society, Societies Act. One can be a trust, and one can be a Section 25 company under Companies Act. In fact, that Section 25 is called Section 8 under new Companies Act, which just came 2 months back.
Right.
So you are a Section 8 company, a Section 8/Section 25 company. It's a non-profit.
Okay. It's a non-profit, but you still need revenue to run it. You said sort of that you're supporting it with your own funds. Where exactly do you see any other revenue? Do you want donors to invest in this non-profit, or how do you see it?
Right. So currently, Yuva is largely based on two models. We conduct a lot of events. That's one thing. Second thing, we work with a lot of volunteers. So out of the couple of things that I told you, we are only working three of them. So volunteers come free of cost. You have to do a lot of hard work to get them in, but they come free of cost. Luckily, so that's being paid already by them. For events, we do get funding. So we conducted some 4 or 5 big events, smaller big events, one on environment in Uttarakhand, a couple of them in Delhi. Events at times get funded, or someone sponsors the everything. And even what you need, even you need a hall, you need a sound system, you need some promotion material, right? And maybe some refreshment. So if someone funds all of this, you need just speakers. Speakers don't chance. So Yuva is currently working a lot of helping in kind. Or we try to partner with a lot of organizations. Let's say set up a civil society. And in fact, I started incubating a lot of organizations. So that's also one role in Yuva plays, which is not in the original charter. That I also help a lot of Yuva youth entrepreneurs, especially the social entrepreneurs. In fact, currently I'm incubating and helping two organizations. One is My Parliament. MY stands for Model Youth Parliament. And another is I Connect with Youth. And then we use their platforms also to engage with youth.
Right. That's great. I'm going to go back to a point you made about volunteers come free of cost.
Right.
There is, however, you need to manage the volunteers, right? I mean, you need to establish a level of professionalism, commitment, discipline. You know, what are your thoughts around that?
So, unfortunately, volunteer movement is still like very, very nascent in India. Very, very nascent in India.
Right.
Still, the religious volunteering is very big in India. So if you go to religious places, be it a temple or a mosque or a church, you get a huge number of volunteers, right?
Right.
So your shoe stand, to cleaning, to serving the everything in any big religious institution. That's age old in India. But volunteering for a cause and which is non attached to religion is still very nascent in India. There's this organization called I Volunteer, which is working in connection with VSO. they are one of the large players we are connecting the volunteers and the organizations. Right. Okay. So I take their help. I take their help in whichever city or geography we want to volunteer. But still, there are not very many ways that you can tap on volunteer. The ways we use that, one is I volunteer. One is you have a Facebook page. It has some 3,000 odd people. We have you use Tata Jagrati space, Jagrati Yatra space at times. Or a lot of such huge pages that we have, Facebook right. pages. And we float a Google form, and every year during summer we run the cycle, and we get normal 300 to 400 online registration, out of which 20 to 25 convert.
Right.
Finally, or 50 come to our initial volunteer engagement session, and then finally 20, 25 work with us throughout the year. Some regular, some not so regular.
So give us an insight into what exactly the projects these volunteers are doing. Give us an insight into that.
Yeah, I'll come to a second thing also, which many people also use. So there's something called National Service Scheme, NSS, which is mandatory. It's a Government of India scheme, which is mandatory for every college student. Uh-huh. So it's a very good way if you tap onto government colleges and find out who is managing the NSS there.
Right.
And you somehow get your NGO registered in that NSS. So if someone spends time with Yuva, that credit will be counted as NSS credits.
Oh, fantastic.
So that's a beautiful way to get volunteers. In fact, those volunteers are forced to because they need those credits, right? And right. once they come in, the work is so interesting that right. many of them continue even without the NSS pressure for NSS credit. So that's a beautiful right. way that many other people can also tap on volunteers.
Right. So what exactly are the projects these volunteers are doing? Give us a window into that.
Right. So these volunteers, they basically go to government schools or low-fee private schools. Government schools are at times difficult because the permission issue and the volunteers are largely available on Sundays. And it's very difficult to get a government school building open because it has loan, the watchman doesn't there, please someone else. So it's easy to crank into low-fee private schools. But these low-fee private schools are in like every lane in India. These big cities, small city, they charge some 100, 200 rupees per month. And they are like, education-wise, in fact, the learning outcomes they produce are better than the well-built and better-paid government schools, but unfortunately they don't produce learning outcome as good as the low-fee private schools. And but many researchers have shown that. So we try to access these along with some government schools, and the volunteers normally do three things. One is they try to teach basic conversational English. We have a module for that. Then we have using a module by Arvind Gupta. Arvind Gupta is an IIT Kanpur guy who's active in Pune and Maharashtra region, and he has created a huge number of videos on how to teach maths and logic. So we use one of his modules to teach logic and then general aptitudes and logic. And some of our volunteers who can carry laptops, we also teach basic computer, handling computer, and at least using MS Office softwares like PPT, Word, Excel, so that they're at least familiar with the file system and they can operate a laptop. So these are the three things normally volunteers go and engage with.
So how do you measure the impact? Do you have any system in place for UR to measure the impact these volunteers are having or, UR is having?
Right. So initially, we didn't have anything. Our measure was only very input-based, that how many volunteers are going and how many kids they're teaching and what is the attendance of the kids. That how so if the kid is coming on every Sunday out of interest, that means at least we are engaging with the kids. So that was our metrics. Now right. we're trying to move to, and some schools have already started, with little sophisticated metrics. So in the start of the year, we try to take a baseline test. And then at the end of the year, so end of the year is yet to come, we will start only this year on this metrics. And at the end of the year, we try to take an inline test and see how much this person improved because of our intervention, of the particular right. thing that we are trying to engage.
So when you say a baseline test, you're basically testing the student before you start your any kind of instructions, right?
Exactly.
Okay. And then, U.S. based in NCR, I assume, right? But you're going to expand to other places. What are your future plans of taking UR, wherever?
Currently may not be geographically. While working in the schools and low-income areas, we have seen one thing that why they don't honor education. A lot of people, because when you go there, you interact with a lot of people, not only kids, right? Because after you sit in a tea stall, you get your car punch.
Hey, we lost your audio. Shantanu, we lost your audio. Yeah, you're back. Go ahead.
I'm back now?
Right. Yeah, go ahead. No, yeah. I lost you. Yeah, go ahead.
Yeah, so in practice, youth, they say education has not paid many of us. They say that person who did his graduation or who did his 12, is still doing the same. So they don't have any role models among themselves, right? So because the quality of education they access is also not very great, and it has done more harm to education because they have not seen any role models, and that further decreases their any incentive to engage in education activity versus doing what the family profession was already is, be it a motor mechanic or anything else.
Right.
So now we try to enter into this market of training placement on the low income category. So this is the area you want to expand in the NCR region itself. So to your question, we may not expand geographically. I may partner with a couple of organizations. I can help them with my expertise, which I earned over the last 5 to 6 years, understanding the youth space and the training and education space. I can help other organizations to not go through the same hard path that I went through. But I think my focus will be more on NCR region and Delhi, Gurgaon, and Noida.
Right. And you have sufficient numbers also, right? For there, I mean, there's enough.
These areas are highly populated. So
So I'm going to shift tracks a little bit, and you know, with all your wide experience in both, you know, hands-on and rural and urban areas, and with policy. I want to understand the philosophy. I want to understand the, you know, you mentioned politics a little bit. You mentioned free markets a little bit. I want to understand the landscape. And, you know, there's a slide that I think you sent to me before this. I want to put it up. If you can explain, like, walk through, you know, the different stakeholders, the different issues, you know, how's the interaction between these stakeholders, your philosophy of what do you see, that'll be great. Okay, let me share the slide. My face might go, but I think the slide will come out. Hold on a second.
Yeah, Anand, you have to give me literally 5 seconds. I have to put my computer on the charge. Very sorry for this.
Yeah.
I'm back with you.
Okay, I'm just going to try to share this slide. See if you can see it. Can you see it?
Yeah, it's up there.
Okay, it's up there, no?
Yeah.
Okay, I'm going to shift the focus to the slide. Can you see it?
I'm able to see it.
Okay, is everybody able to see it? Can anybody say if they can see it or not? Can you give
people are saying yes on the chat. People are saying yes on the chat.
Okay, yes. Go ahead then, Shank.
Okay.
Yeah, go ahead.
So Anand, if you see, this slide shows various stakeholders in education. So on the left, you see the main beneficiary, the child, and then the teacher, the parent, the government, and private. As I told you earlier, I take normally a two-hour session on this slide itself, but I try to give the main essence, which I get how I conclude the session. So if you see, child and parent, we can consider them as the consumer of the system, right?
Right.
And the teacher, government, and private bodies, we can consider this as the producer of the education system, right?
Right.
And if you see for the government schooling, child has a very weak voice because the bodies like NCPC and SCPC are hardly functioning, so he can't raise his complaint anywhere. He doesn't have a huge choice that what kind of school he chooses. His choice is limited by the city he lives in or the kind of money his parents and access. He doesn't have a choice.
Right.
Parents, the government school parents, they have structured like school management committees and village education committees. Various researches have shown that parents even don't know that the parents who are part of the committee don't even know that they're part of the committee. So they have a very weak voice. So children and parents have a very weak voice. The children and parents who's assessing the government school system. On the contrary, the teachers' union have a huge voice. Huge voice because they conduct Indian elections in upper house. Aided school teachers have reservation. They conduct census for government of India. So they have a huge voice in the system because of the teachers' union. The government has a huge voice because they can pass whatever law they want to pass. High fee private schools have a huge voice because they have big money. Their network. They can access courts against government. Apart from the low fee private schools. Everyone has a huge voice. So if you see, if you cut my slide diagonally, if you see the child and the parent have a weak voice, And teacher and a government and a private private schools have a high voice, a strong voice.
Right.
You consider any system where consumer has a weak voice and a producer a high and a strong voice. The system right. will be what we have. Now coming to the incentive system. In India, the child doesn't have an inherent incentive to go to a school. The school is a very boring structure. It's still a very age-old chalk and talk method.
Right.
A government school teacher has an incentive to go, has an incentive to take a government job, but does not have any incentive to teach while he's in the school. Because he doesn't get paid for the teaching, or he's not even get fired if he doesn't teach. His only target is basically to complete the syllabus, right?
Mm-hmm.
The parents who send him to government school, government has created a lot of structures like degree, free scholarship, free dress, but these incentives are not working good. In fact, you know what parents do in large part of UP and Bihar? They enroll their children to government school and send them to private school, so that from the government school they can get all the freebies and the good education they get from the private school. So the incentives are not working.
We try to see
what incentives government has. So in fact, we studied the 2012 all election manifestos, 2009 all election manifestos, and we have seen that education none of the party has spent great length of the time, and none of the star speakers of the government. We have not analyzed 2014 election, so we can do that. This is a outdated research. So people have not political parties not enough, and this goes from my talking to a lot of MPs, and they say because education is a deferred gratification, it doesn't pay electorally. That's why they also don't focus on education. Coming to the private entity, currently, and this is a surprise for many when I say that in India, education is a not-for-profit sector. So all your colleges, all your schools, all your DPSs to model school, Barakambas, to every school, every college in India is a not-for-profit entity by law. In fact, in India, you can't create a for-profit education institution. You can put a service provider. You can be an Educom or a book publisher for-profit. But to run a school or a college, you have to be a non-for-profit. Because of that, two things happen. And you need at least 17 to 18 licenses to run an organization, right? So you can start a yatra.com or a redbus.in without zero money. And investors invest in you. But you can start a school with zero money. Because in a non-profit, there is no structure for investing.
Right.
And to get 17 or 18 licenses, you need a political clout, right? So currently, someone who has deep pockets, because you can't get financing, someone who has deep pockets and someone who has political connections can only open a private institution of the school. And we blame the private schools are fleecing us. But my point is that we are only allowed a certain kind of people to open a private school.
Right.
Any yatri entrepreneur, it's very difficult to start a, because you can't access money from the market, and it's damn difficult to get to 17, 20 licenses.
So what is your philosophy in reforming this system? I mean, you give it a good layout.
In the interest
of time, what is your philosophy? Yeah.
So every country can have like a time-bound solution, right? So let's say what solution is valid for next 10 years, then maybe we have to find better solution. So currently we can do 3-4 things, right? Let's say if we declare all the government funds as per child fund. Currently government funds it's at the state budget. It is an overall state budget and then divided by the number of students enrolled in the government schools, and then you come at the per child cost. If you start the government funding as per child funding, then every citizen can compare it to private schools. And I think a very surprising figure. In Delhi, government spends around 1190 rupees per child per month in a government school. So Delhi government spends 1190 rupees on every child every month in a government school. And 85% of private schools of Delhi charge below 1190 rupees.
Right.
Which shows the government is highly, highly, highly inefficient.
Right.
Because we think the government doesn't have money. Government has a lot of money, right? They're spending more than what private schools are charging, right?
So give us a 5 or 6 proposals from your side.
Number one is if we can change the government funding into per child funding.
Right.
Number two, if we start giving this money as vouchers to children. So I will say tomorrow that this 1190 rupees should be given to every child who wants to access any kind of school. If he wants to come to government school, very good. If he wants to go to a private school, we don't mind. We were anyway spending this 11, right? That's the second solution. So convert all this money to government into vouchers, because cash has its own problem, because cash can be spent in other things for the family, right? That's why convert it into vouchers, which can go to these schools. Third thing, for government school teachers, convert their salaries into performance-based salaries. And the performance should be linked with the learning outcomes like the baseline end-end test, which we do in our interventions. So if the child performs good at the end of the year, a particular teacher should get a bonus.
Right.
And fourth thing, make education a for-profit sector, because anyway it's for-profit. It's for-profit, but it's undercover and through creative accounting. So can you make it obvious and at least put the sham that education is not for profit, so that at least the private money and because currently the big lines that you see in front of the 200 big schools in Delhi is not because everyone wants to be in those good schools, because no good school is being opened in the last 50 years, because it's very different to open a school.
Right.
So if you make private schools opening easy, a single window clearance, if you do this four steps, and to enable these four steps, can we start a student assessment, a very objective student assessment of every child, which can then be rolled out to a child, you can pull up a teacher, you can pull up a principal, you can name and shame a school, a government school, a private school, and a kind of a rating for the school based on the assessment. So right. If you do five things for the next 10 years, you will see Indian education at a very different level.
I'm just going to raise one point since we don't have much time. There are counter arguments to saying that if you test students, it's not on the teacher alone. There are a lot of things, factors which are out of school factors for any child anywhere. It's the family, it's the environment, it's the poverty. There's a bunch of things that are cited. So what is your counterpoint to that?
Yeah, so I'm saying a lot of people raising this point, a lot of people raising a parallel point that if you start taking tests, teacher will start teaching to test. So I've accounted both this argument. First of all, this is the only primary factor which is under control, right? The teacher transaction. At least we will improve this. Okay. And by virtue of a lot of other government policies of poverty and all, that will anyway improve. Because education, MHRD, government cannot do everything, right? MHRD, government cannot provide jobs to. So MHRD can only have control on its teachers, right? This is at least the very important factor. So you're right, the home background. But MHRD cannot change the home background of a child, right? So at least the education ministry, whatever it is in control. And as India is progressing, as the GDP, per capita GDP is rising, anyway students are moving from government school to private schools, right? At least this way you can stop that sodas from government schools to private schools. And if your teacher are more accountable and the salaries are, and whatever is speaking, I'm based on research, and long period of research, which I normally quote in messages.
Right.
Currently in the positive time, I'm not quoting.
Right. And that's great. I think this is a great introduction to the landscape out there based on your experience and your philosophies. I'm going to move on because we really are short of time. Who are your personal role models, Shantanu?
I'll not say none, but whenever I see even in a pawn shop or someone, any kind of small entrepreneur, because I also work with a lot of small big entrepreneurs, right? And I know this fact that creating a job, creating a self-employment is a very tough landscape in India, and not because there are not many customers, because the government permissions are so problematic.
Right.
In fact, I'll invite everyone to read this book by an IIM Bangalore professor, Professor R. Vaidyanathan. It's called India Uninc. And he basically beautifully argues this fact that the poor unincorporated India. Unincorporated India means the people who are not forming big companies and your ready walas and thela walas and your shop, they are running the country, right? 60% of our GDP is constituted because of them. So I think my role models are the small entrepreneurs, which are running their enterprise beautifully, and they have no muscle against the government, and government, they face huge government harassment. So I'm saying they are my role models.
And what is your personal evolution from the time you started in this sector to where you are right now, based on your experience? Can you share a couple of things?
Sure. I think I'll say I was able to explore myself more closely because eight, nine years in corporate, my goals, and nothing against the corporate, they have their own role. But my thinking process was my share investments, to maybe some land I want to purchase, or some apartment I want to invest in, or maybe I want to upgrade my car. And now where like I'm more aware, I can help a lot many people. I contribute in. I'm part of a lot of panels and government discussion. And in fact, I laugh sitting in a lot of these very senior government panels where I recommend things on education, and I laughed my work before that. I was sitting in Credit Suisse of Wipro and helping a software company to grow its revenue, right? So I think I reward as a person, have a better understanding of myself, able to help a lot of many people, improve my own articulation about what I want to say in over years, right? Able to affect my immediate family in very many ways, able to change, in fact, I changed the career path of a lot of people in last 5-6 years. So yeah, these are a couple of things I can say.
I mean, that's gratifying. How do people get a hold of you? And how, if they're interested in you or volunteering for you, how do they get a hold of you?
So I'm located in Delhi, very much available. Meet almost 4 to 5 new people every week, if not every day, at times a day also. So in one of the slides I put my number, but if you're not able to project it, my phone number is 9871-929-440, or they can write to me at shantanu@yuva-foundation.com.
And we
have a Facebook page. Our site is not up from last 2 weeks. On our site also you can get all this information, but I'm available on my phone and email. I'm on the Jagrati email group and Jagrati Facebook page.
Right.
These are also the ways to
connect. Right. Alok Mishra had a question. He asked, what about teaching the teachers to show some kind of personal coaching for students? The problem with teaching in India is that every student has to excel in curriculum. What about inherent capabilities?
So, Mr. Alok, I'll try to handle the larger problem of teaching, at least the teaching, teacher training in government school. At least 12 to 13 large-scale randomized controlled trial research have proved them that teacher training have not resulted in any kind of learning outcome in children. Which sounds very bizarre. And the reason is that after any teacher training, teacher improves as a person in his own knowledge. But his incentive system, while after going back to the school, remains the same. So his incentive structure to communicate what he learned in the training is still zero. Right. So teacher training. You're right. Can help improve a person. But until unless you improve his incentive structure or a very high level of monitoring, so that he will transact the same in the class. So until as you plug this incentive structure or monitoring structure, teacher training will do no good. But otherwise, innovative teacher trainings surely will help.
Alok, is a follow-up question. I'm going to ask that as well because I don't see any other questions. But government schools are responsible for a great number of future citizens. What about their quality? So I think you talked about government schools before, right?
Right. So right. I'll give you a small landscape. So in India, around there's 70% government schools and 30% private schools. But almost 40 to 45% children go to private schools. So this private school is a big capacity. That's why more children go to less number of private schools, right? And in urban areas, this figure is pulled up. So it's reversed, right? So Mumbai and Delhi, 60% children go to private schools and rest to government schools. And various researches have shown that a private school charging an equivalent fees than a private and a government school cost performs far more better than a government school. So government schools are doing fairly poor. And the reason is, as I told you the same, the incentive structure in the government school, apart from some specialized government schools like Kendriya Vidyalayas and Navodaya Vidyalayas, is abysmal. And the ASSA report, the Education Initiative report, the PISA report, they all show the same.
RT has a question. Has time come for policy think tanks in India?
I think the policy think tanks are already there for a while. In fact, if you see University of Pennsylvania ranking, where CCS Center for Civil Society, where I used to work, has a global ranking of 51, which is highest for any Indian think tank. So you can say CCS is the top rated Indian think tank in any international think tank ranking. But this University of Pennsylvania, in their research, they say that they have audited almost 250 think tanks. So India has almost 250 to 255 think tanks. But with the age-old planning commission kind of structure is also now moving to think tanks. Think tanks age has come, I guess. I think that the two main problems for upcoming of think tanks is that in India, there's no the social sciences are not studied much still. There are not very many great colleges for experienced people. to do social sciences. Recently now, a couple of IIMs have started policy schools. Jindal School has started policy. Second thing is still there's not much donations on policy side. So I know a lot of these policy think tanks struggle for donations because of the lack of photo opportunity, if I say so, or something which is very tangible. Because policy advocacy is very long fought battle, right? You may not see any big change in many years. That's why it's very difficult to get funded for policy. These are the two major problems, human resource and funding for policy.
Right. Okay, Alok, stay on and ask the question. I'm going to end the formal broadcast now, but we can continue the conversation after that. Shantanu, thank you very much for your time today. It's been very enlightening. We wish your foundation the best from Jagriti Yatra.
Thanks a lot. Thanks a lot for having me here. Thank you.
All right, I'm going to just stop the broadcast, right? Yeah.